Evolutionary Psychology, to better understand your world. A YouTube video channel about the power of evolutionary thinking. Animals and plants are not our main subject of discussion. People, politics and societies are. Inspiring, sometimes controversial, but always stretching your mind. In part one on innovation, we explored, among other things, sex and convergent evolutions. Nature picks innovations from a small set of preferred solutions and ignores a huge ocean of possible options. As it goes in nature, so it goes in the development of technology and culture. We explored some of these processes that can clarify these phenomena. We saw that evolution is never about revolutions. The first, second and third floor have to be ready before the roof can be built. Also, other conditions have to be right. The Aztecs invented the wheel, but lacked horses or oxen, and never made it into a viable wagon or carriage. Earlier developments facilitate later developments, but they can also make them impossible after some thresholds have been passed. Think about flying. Flying mouses are more likely to come into existence than flying bears. Weight is the crucial factor here. In technology, this phenomenon is known as the law of inhibiting advantage. Sometimes there is no way back after some thresholds have been passed. A vivid illustration of this is the way the keys are positioned on a keyboard. Originally, they were designed for a mechanical typewriter. The speed of typing had to be slowed down in order for the mechanical letter arms not to block. There's logic in this, as long as you use mechanical typewriters. But in modern times, the QWERTY system is fully outdated. Experiments with other positions of the keys proved that many other ways of placing keys are far more efficient, much faster and much more ergonomic. But QWERTY has never changed. Why? Simply because it would be an operation too big, with too many opposing stakeholders involved. So this change has never occurred, and we are stuck with a suboptimal design. Another example. All technology for electrical driven cars is available. Why don't we use it? Again, an easy answer. Because it is held back by the existing powerful infrastructure of gasoline factories and gasoline stations. Mobile phones in Africa spread themselves much faster than in Europe or the USA. Why? Because they didn't have to compete against an old structure of traditional phones. The width of the space shuttle and the width of buttocks of oxen and horses are exactly matched on each other. Why is this, for heaven's sake? You might ask yourself. The story goes as follows. Roman chariots, 2000 years ago, had a standardized size. Roads were adapted to that. To be more precisely, the width of two oxen, 4 feet and 8.5 inches. British roads for long distances remained this size, even after the Romans had left this island. Iron tramways, first pulled by horses, were adapted to this size. No change took place after the invention of steam power. Just as in evolution, every step was adapted to the last step before it. The USA adopted British standards. Railroad tunnels were just wide enough for these vehicles. Part of the space shuttle were transported by trains and couldn't be bigger than the tunnels they had to pass. That's why. So, trace back the pedigree of seemingly illogical things and you will always find the logical origins. Dumb decisions once made, we are stuck with it until eternity. The same happened in nature. The Dutch professor Piet Vroom wrote a book called 40 Complaints at the Creator. It's about all the examples of bad design in nature, caused by accumulating new design on top of old design, by always using earlier building blocks. Back pain in humans and birth pain in women is caused by our yet unfinished bipedalism. A special vein of a giraffe has a peculiar, unpractical long root, because it originated at fish where the logic of it was clear. Read the book of Piet Vroom if you want to have more examples. But this demonstrates indisputably evolution does not think ahead. It does nothing to anticipate on future problems. There's only one rule. What works now? What does fit with the steps taken before and with the actual conditions in the here and now? That's why creation sometimes is more about stupid design than about intelligent design. We said it before, quoting the renowned thinker Matt Ridley, ideas are having sex too. The essence of sex is transferring solutions found in one family line to another family line. This was the moment evolution fundamentally shifted to a higher gear. Let's see how this works with non-biological entities. Look at this specimen of one of the earliest printing presses as invented in Europe. China was hundreds of years ahead on us with this invention, but over there it never matured into a technological and economical viable piece of equipment. One elementary component was missing out there, the support of the people in power. Mandarins effectively stopped the spreading of this revolutionary technology. In Europe, on the other hand, the Reformation was a force that speeded up the invention and development of the printing press. There was a huge demand on Bibles written in the languages of the different European countries. Before that, Bibles were only written in Latin. So this new piece of technology was more than welcome. And this speeded up its evolution. The printing press seemed to appear all of a sudden as a completely new equipment. Closer studies, however, tell us a quite different story. Not very much on this machine was in fact new. Printing was already in use by then. Noblemen sealed the letter by pushing their seal ring on a hot wax on a paper of an official document. Paper and ink had long been in use. The wooden screw propeller already existed for some years and found its origin in olive and wine factories. There, the pressing technique had its baby and child years, and later it transferred to book printing. And what you see here is a very common process in innovation. Different solutions from the most diverse fields make horizontal transfers to a new field, printing in this case. A lot of existing ideas had sex in the sense of exchanging solutions. And this way, new inventions emerged. Creativity is foremost about finding and stealing the right ideas. By the way, the printing press is an excellent example of a convergent evolution. It was almost simultaneously invented in Germany by Gutenberg, Belgium by Martens, and in Holland by Koster. The countries have long been quarreling about who was the real inventor and who has stolen the idea from whom. But we now know this isn't the issue. Most probably, they emerged fully independent from one another. We talked about Native Americans inventing the wheel. Long it was thought they didn't because no physical remains were found. No pieces of carriages, wheels, chariots or wheelbarrows were found. But what they did find were toys with wheels. So they did know the wheel. But just like the printing press in China, the wheel in pre-Columbian America never grew to technological and economical adulthood. The reason? There were no horses or oxen available. By the way, if this surprises you, because you were thinking about Indians on horses, in the future I will post a video about the transformation of our hunter-gatherer life to farmers. And there we will see why Americans had horses, had lost them, and how they got them back. The old world had horses. This completed the wheel technology. And horses? We will see what an enormous difference these animals did make in the history of mankind. By the way, it was the grandmaster of evolutionary theory, Charles Darwin himself, who pointed out that ideas grew as a result of fusing in other and previous ideas. In his memoirs, Darwin writes about the ideas he himself used to build up the theory of evolution. He was very impressed by the concepts of Charles Lyell, who wrote extensively about the shifting of continents. Imagine the impact of this idea. Man had always been told that God created the world, more or less, in the shape as we see it today. Then geologists came up with this crazy idea that continents drift over the surface of the earth, and that they didn't only tell it, they proved it as well. In Darwin's head, it planted an idea he couldn't get rid of. If the surface of the earth is constantly changing, could the same be true for species? Further, he read Malthus on his observation of the many more youngsters being born than resources are available. Darwin added to this idea the idea of selection. From the German physiologist Rathke, he got the idea that fetuses of all species look very much alike. You, for example, had gills and had a tail when you were only 2 or 3 centimeters big, just like fish have. Fish, however, kept their gills and tails. You've gotten rid of it. Rutger's idea was that every individual goes through the whole of our common history, from fish to reptile to mammal to man. Darwin was very much impressed by these speculations and used it extensively in his own thinking. And not to forget, Darwin lived in a time where the discussion between science and religion was going to its peak, and Charles picked a side based on immense thinking and doing research. What would have happened if Darwin wasn't born, or when he died as a child or in his teens? Would the world lack a theory of evolution? Certainly not. We know of at least one person with a full-grown exact copy of the theory of evolution, Russell Wallace. It seems like new developments have their own kind of time slots. If Darwin lived a century earlier, he would surely not be able to formulate the theory of evolution by means of natural selection. If he lived 20 years later, someone else would have gone with the prize, and Darwin would be no more than a good scientist, a footnote in specialist book on the history of biology. Thinking in this line, what would have happened if Hitler never was born, or had he died as a child? I dare to say we would have got the Second World War anyhow. All the ingredients that inflicted this disaster were clear and present in that time slot. Anti-Semitism and the need of a scapegoat, the humiliation of Versailles, seeking revenge on France, lack of territory to house the growing German population, the development of new weapons, the danger from the East, Stalin, and communist revolution, etc., etc. Just like Darwin and Wallace, if not Hitler, someone else would have tied the knots together and ignited the fire. Of course, there are always an element of coincidence, of probability. Evolution is no mathematics. A well-known example is Post-it 3M. It was an accidental side effect of R&D at glues. And there are more examples of the striking impact of coincidence. Research at Agina Pectoris led to the development of Viagra. Thomas Sullivan, a tea merchant, thought tin cans were too expensive, so he shifted to the much cheaper little linen sacks. Customers forgot to unpack the sacks and put everything together in hot water. This way, the tea bag was born. Not even an idea, just an accident. Okay, so far so good. To finish, let's look at the other side of innovation, the factors that inhibit renewal. Evolution gives us some powerful suggestions. The most important of these is avoid monocultures at all costs. I will explain. Biologists talk of giantism when individual members of a species grow very big, when they grow into giants. There are plenty of examples of this happening. Megaloceros was a huge deer, bigger than any species of deer living nowadays. It had antlers up to 4 meters. Megalodon was a giant shark with jaws of over 2 meters. Sarcosuchus, a crocodile of 12 meters long. He ate normal crocs for breakfast. The elephant bird weighs in about 500 kilograms. And dinosaurs are, of course, all too familiar. What do these giants have all in common? Right. They are not here anymore. They got extinct. Why? The answer has to do with the curse of eternal life. Why don't we live forever? The oldest man known was 141 years old. His name? Faraz ad-Din Mir from Kashmir. But records are not sure of this. Really verified on his age is Walter Brönnings. See picture. He died at the age of 114 years. In the animal kingdom, we find examples that surpass him. Some sea urchins easily pass 200 years. The Galapagos giant turtle is known to live 250 to 300 years. And some giant mussels can age to 400. Seagrass, cloning to a giant organism weighing 6,000 tons, is estimated to be 10,000 years old. In California, there's a pine tree called Methuselah, and scientists have determined his age to be over 5,000 years. But these are the rare exceptions. Most species live a lot shorter, and with good reason. Let's have a little thought experiment. Imagine an island full of trees that grow extremely old. They produce offspring, but in fact they have no chance. All space is occupied by the old generation. They keep producing seeds, but to no avail. When you look at the genetic diversity of these seeds, it turns out to be quite limited. See the picture I have made of this. Limited variation. Is this a problem? Yes, it is. As long as conditions are stable, nothing goes wrong. But when circumstances change, for example, a much hotter or colder climate, there have to be a plan B. That is, there have to be some mutations in store to deal with these new conditions. They become the founding fathers of a new generation of adapted trees. And with the limited variations, the probability of such plan B is quite small. Compare this to smaller species like bacteria, viruses, or insects. Their way of reproducing goes as follows. What have these small species in common? First, individuals have a short lifespan, but they produce many offsprings. The periods between generations are small. Add up these factors and their adaptability is much greater because of the enormous diversity produced this way. Bacteria getting resistant to antibiotics are an example of these forms of superfast evolution. So, these small devils will always survive, while the big giants become extinct. Giantism is a dead-end street in evolution. One can ask, if the big ones always get extinct, why did they come into existence in the first place? The answer is short-term benefit and long-term sufferings. As we saw, evolution is short-sighted. It doesn't look at the long-term consequences. Big individuals have advantage in sexual selection, especially when competition between males plays a big role. Also, the big guys have almost no natural enemies. An adult blue whale can only be killed by man. No other animal can master it. So, being big is good for you, but bad for your species. And because of this, time and time again, some species make the mistake of becoming giants. But evolution is sooner or later always correcting this mistake. A lack of diversity is called monoculture. Monocultures are the most toxic poisons for healthy development, in nature as well as in human societies. Monocultures is the opposite of innovation. To give an example out of the social domain, business gurus Peters and Waterman found out that organizations with strong cultures, that is, everyone is thinking and wanting the same, do better than organizations with diverse cultures. At least so it appeared, because Peters and Waterman only looked at short-term gains. Some years later, other behavioral scientists took a closer look at the winners of a few years back. And to their astonishment, they discovered that a substantial number of those companies had gone bankrupt. Why? Monocultures do well in one kind of environment, but when circumstances change, they appear to be less adaptive than more diverse corporations. So, however attractive monocultures may seem, always be on the alert. The danger comes later. And now for the scary part. In the modern Western world, we are building up monocultures like hell. We are making ourselves more and more vulnerable by willingly making ourselves dependent on one or two solutions and neglecting diversity, not having a plan B when needed. I'll give you some examples. The internet is a worldwide uniform system of computers all connected. What will happen if a strong virus calls the whole systems to a halt? Big finance appear to be too tightly connected, and they had grown into one gigantic international financial institutions, too big to fail. Then in 2008, it all went wrong, and taxpayers had to bail them out. If our financial system had been built up of many small banks, this problem would never have occurred, or it could have been solved in a different way. International traveling made us vulnerable to pandemics that would only be local problems a few centuries back. Compare the dynamics of COVID-19 and the plague in the 14th century. Modern dairy cows produce 10,000 kilograms of milk a year. That's 3 to 4 times as much as 15 years back. But all those super cows descend from a handful of super bulls, like the one here, Sunny Boy. If it turns out they are carrying genetic diseases, which manifest themselves only after some generations, dairy farmers are in big trouble, including an important part of our own food production. Furthermore, the world depends for about 70% on three kinds of plants, maize, soya and wheat. Here again, what will happen if an aggressive plant disease kills all soya? It would mean a disaster for mankind. Think of it, and you will learn how scary this is. Things could go terribly wrong, and I mean terribly. However profitable monocultures can be on the short time, we have to be ultra carefully not to make ourselves dependent on them. Now they look like angels, they may well turn out to be demons. I hope I didn't make you feel depressed too much by this ending. Anyway, don't forget to visit our next vision video, and that is coming soon. The next two videos, we will dive in a very interesting, but also highly controversial topic: differences between men and women. What does biology and evolutionary psychology have to say about this? We will take a critical stance against political and social movements that neglect the nature side in the nature-nurture debate. Especially, I will take a firm stance against the more radical forms of feminism. I hope to make clear the distinction between good and bad feminism. So, I hope to meet you next time. And if you like this video, please share it and don't forget to like and subscribe.